This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, the first meeting of the school merger transition team, and Senator Lamar Alexander steps down from his Senate leadership post. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer, and hosted by Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News.
Welcome to Behind the Headlines. Our first topic tonight is one of a number of firsts that we're going to see in the school merger. Bill, there was a meeting this week of the school planning committee and the new unified school board. And you described it as a fairly informal affair, which is interesting after so much turmoil, so much fighting. They all got together, some 30-something people, and what happened?
They listened a lot, which is probably what they're going to be doing for the next few meetings. The Planning Commission can go ahead and get started anytime it wants to, and they will next week with an organizational session. The countywide school board, they get sworn in on October 3rd. Technically, they go to work on October 1st. That's when the new terms for the new board begins. But they got them all in one room called the Fishbowl Room at the University of Memphis at the FedEx Institute of Technology, and they basically got things laid out in terms of here's the open meetings law, this is what you can do, this is what you can't do. And they heard from Martavius Jones, the chairman of the city school board, David Pickler, the chairman of the county school board, and County Mayor Mark Luttrell about kind of the challenges facing them. Several of these members are completely new to political service. So Luttrell kind of gave them a fair warning and said, look, this is very complex, you know this, but what you don't know is you're probably going to be challenged in every way on this.
And one of the part of the discussion, correct me if I'm wrong, was the Planning Commission is, you know, what are their marching orders? And what if they don't, completely agree? What if they think there are a couple of routes and they, you know, can they present a couple of plans to the Unified School Board? What was talked about on that front?
The way that Luttrell laid it out with help from the county attorney's office is that basically the Planning Commission does the detail work on how the merger works, how the system is set up, what kind of purchasing systems, all of the minutia. The Planning Commission does that. And at some point, it submits it to the state for approval, the State Department of Education. Now, there's still some vagary about whether it goes to the combined school board first or after, but basically the combined school board has to sign off on whatever the Planning Commission does at some point, be it before the state gets it or after the state gets
it. And also in the news this week was Kreiner Cash, the superintendent of the city schools, who now works for the Unified School Board, who spoke at, I believe, the Rotary Club, talked about some of the reforms he's tried to put in place, and he was an opponent of this consolidation, pretty active one, but he spoke somewhat positively about it, and some of the reforms that he's put in place in the city schools he think will carry over into this unified school district.
Yeah, he talked to the Midtown Republican Club actually about this and said, well, I want my reforms to be viewed in the context of a countywide school system, and he's saying that he's on board with it now and he wants to make the reforms happen. He certainly doesn't want the reforms to be forgotten about once we reach that date in 2013 when you have one school system instead of two. And he talked about it in very blunt terms about some of the reservations he has about charter schools, about some of the policies that he's had in terms of a mix of new teachers and veteran teachers in the classroom.
Yeah, and we have some sound from Kreiner Cash speaking. Let's go to that.
Board is still in existence until 2013. So that's why I say this is the last board meeting. I don't feel like that. I feel like we're going to continue to do business for another 2 years.
And Jackson, Cash is a sometimes polarizing figure. Some people really like what he's doing in terms of, you know, changes in teacher reform, teacher tenure, you know, proposing to close a number of schools, which just came this week, three schools were proposed. Some people really don't like him. They view him as a kind of an arrogant figure. I mean, where do you think that plays out over the next couple of years as all this transition is taking place? What will Cash's role be?
Well, I wouldn't hold my breath till he gets his reforms adopted by this new all-county system, because it was the fear of the kind of bureaucracy that he and his administration have represented to people in the outer county that was one of the impediments to this merger taking place. So I think he's dreaming if he sees his reform is really taking root in the new system. And by the way, even though that meeting was one more chorus of kumbaya, there were, I'm informed, some muttered conversations among some of the people there. A couple of the Shelby County school board members were trying to hotbox one of the newly named school board members about the idea that the suburbs really do need to go their own way. So you're going to see some dissension as this thing moves forward. I'm reminded of the meeting of the Constitutional Commission in 1789. We think of, you know, everything being kumbaya then too, but in fact the group that became the Federalists and the group that became the Republicans were fighting tooth and nail. They had gridlock. Gridlock's going to be involved in this.
Well, and let's also remember that this is all about counting votes, and neither the 9-member city school board nor the 7-member Shelby County school board in and of themselves have a majority on this new body, so that, you know, if they're about forming a coalition, they have to have some of the new members.
All right. Well, we'll leave it there and see how those coalitions build over the coming weeks and months. We move on to city council and a proposal to change the way that the city council votes on taxes. Amos, tell us what that proposal was and how it ended up.
In June, the council slapped taxpayers with a one-time property tax increase of 18 cents. Councilman Kemp Conrad, he's a Republican who voted for that tax increase. He had proposed putting a question to voters and letting voters decide whether or not it should be more difficult for the council to raise taxes. His proposal would require a two-thirds majority to raise taxes if the rate of the tax, the percentage rate of the tax increase was higher than inflation or population growth. The vote went down, split completely along racial lines. It failed 7-6, with the 7 African American council members voting against the proposal and the 6 white members voting for the proposal. You had some odd moments during this debate and exchange where you had the vice president of the Memphis Police Association saying that putting this question before voters would disenfranchise voters, which is a little odd.
Which goes to the argument that you've got, if the minority has this power, and it's the Senate, on the federal level, the Senate, people criticize the fact that you need this supermajority to get anything through the Senate. And so the Senate is gridlocked. And I think that's what the critics say about these supermajority structures.
I think a representative from AFSCME really got closer to the heart of the matter by essentially saying Memphis is a majority African-American city. And so you have white council members who essentially want to control the ability to raise taxes by making it a two-thirds majority, and basically indicated that African-American residents aren't all that concerned about raising taxes, or that it indicated that it should be as easy as a simple majority.
Let's go to some sound we have from that meeting. I think this is Joe Brown.
We run for the seats we have, so we can make the choices. The people elect us to speak for them and on their behalf.
Excuse me, that was Harold Collins. Sorry, I had that.
And Harold is basically saying, well, then what are we here for? You know, we're elected to make the tough decisions. Are we going to put Beale Street Landing to a vote before people, or the Bass Pro? His take was basically, where do we stop with
and
this?
Again,
and this,
you know,
is
the
why
argument,
we're elected.
And Bill, bring you in. The argument is that, look, we don't want to, the people in favor of this proposal, we're saying we don't want tax increases to be done willy-nilly. We want to really make it a hard thing to do. The other folks are saying, look, we've been, as Harold Collins just said there, we've been elected to represent the people. If they don't like what we're doing, they can throw us out of office.
Yeah, this is a very important important moment for the city council, especially in light of this supposedly one-time only 18-cent tax hike. You mark my words, next spring when the city budget season begins, there will be several members on the city council who will look at this and will say, well, you know, people are already paying the 18 cents. Why don't we go ahead and make it part of the tax hike? As things stand now, because of the council vote, you only need 7 votes to do that. And you only need 7 votes, in effect, to prove the old adage that there is no such thing as a temporary tax hike.
All right. We'll leave it there and see. That proposal is dead and has been voted down for this year. Right. Okay. We move on to taxes are playing a big role in the federal, the race for president. The Republican debates have been going on, and a number of Republican candidates have been in town or are about to be in town. Let's start with you, Andy. Who was in town this last week trying to raise money?
Former Massachusetts Governor Mitt Romney was at the office of former Saks Incorporated CEO Brad Martin, raising money, meeting the donors and the big shots here. He precedes current Texas Governor Rick Perry, who will be in town this coming Wednesday at the Memphis Botanic Garden. And it's interesting. I mean, we're 13, 14 months away from the big dance. The primary's coming up March, I believe. And you've got the two leading Republican presidential candidates here. It really speaks to, I would argue, us more than it does them, just, Shelby County being this, citadel of Republican votes and a concentration of the base. They pretty much have to be here. And this certainly underscores that.
And Tennessee is not in play. I'm just bringing you in, Jackson, in any way in the general election for president. It's pretty,
These days, it is not. You get it in the Republican.
But you've got a lot of shifts in Tennessee Republican Party, where you've got an ever more conservative, Tea Party driven, however you want to say that, faction in the legislature. You've got some real conservative candidates like Michelle Bachmann and so on, who may be coming through here later after Perry. So really, this is not so much campaign area, but it's a lot of fundraising that's going to go on in Tennessee. And that Super Tuesday, I guess, could say something about where the presidential election goes and where the Republican Party in Tennessee is really pointing.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how Perry's turnout on Wednesday compares to Romney's this past week, because Perry, in a recent straw poll that the largest Republican club in Shelby County held, Perry got 51 votes in their straw vote. Romney got 6. That tells you how the rank and file is viewing things. And the conservative leadership of Tennessee, symbolized by Ron Ramsey, the lieutenant governor, is very much behind Perry. He'll probably be here for that. I'm sure he'll be here for that fundraiser. People like Brian Kelsey, the more conservative
state senator from Germantown.
Yeah, legislators, and a good many rank and file people. Well,
is there any indication at this point where Haslam is leaning? I mean, has he played his cards at all? I mean, he's a governor.
He said that he's going to hold off.
Now, you correct me where I'm wrong. Stereotypically, Haslam would tend to be more in the Romney camp, the more moderate, business-oriented.
Privately, he'd probably vote that way.
Versus the ideological Republican that Perry represents.
He'll probably vote that way on Super Tuesday, but basically he's playing host to all whatever Republicans come through the state.
And let me also bring up, this is against another Republican, longtime political figure in Tennessee, Lamar Alexander, quit his post as the number 3 top-ranking official in the Senate. We've got a little sound from him talking about that, and we'll come back and comment on it.
Stepping down from the Republican leadership will liberate me to spend more time trying to work for results on issues that I care the most about. For the same reason I plan to step down in January from the leadership, I will not be a candidate for the leadership in the next Congress.
Number one was he heard the footsteps of Jim DeMint of South Carolina behind him and people of that persuasion. He probably was going to face a very close vote, maybe might not have held on to his position in the next Congress. But beyond that, Lamar has been one of the few figures in the Republican leadership who has been trying to work across the aisle and resolve some of these financial questions of the last year. He was very much in favor of the Gang of Six, the 3 Republicans, the 3 Democrats, who tried to hammer out some consensus but didn't get anywhere, and they had revenues
on
their
table. Folks like that have been targeted. There was the person in the longtime Republican senator in Utah who failed to win his primary. I mean, is there any sense that Alexander isn't a shoe-in for re-election?
No, but there's kind of rumblings about Corker.
But I think both of them are shoe-ins when you get down to it.
Okay.
But I think Lamar is safe that way. But as he says, he is now liberated to play an intermediary's role. It doesn't have to parrot that.
Right.
Same thing happened to Bill Frist when he was majority leader. He had to do things that weren't really in his heart.
All right. Well, we leave it there. We'll move on to an economic update, starting with the groundbreaking, which is coming up for Electrolux. Numbers have covered that. I'm going to start with you, Amos. It's a massive project. It was one of the first big economic development announcements last year, or in the last year, as Wharton has taken over and Luttrell has taken over. A lot of hope. A lot of the city governments, business leaders have been very much in favor of it. The CA had a series of articles that raised a lot of doubts, a lot of skepticism about some parts of the deal. Tell us about that.
The most incentives for any project in West Tennessee in modern history, over $100 million city, county, and state are investing in this project. Recently, within the last several weeks, bids for construction work came back, and they were $30 million over what the company had expected, which it literally sent shockwaves through government and business circles. For a few days there, people were very, very concerned whether that project was even going to be viable going forward. The company is working that out with the contractors to reduce cost, and they have set a groundbreaking date for October 5th. This thing will employ around 1,250 people when it's fully operational. Part of the real payoff is going to be the suppliers, who will produce double the number of jobs as the actual plant itself. And this is a key part of the mayoral race, too. Mayor Wharton touts this project, Mitsubishi, City Brewing, the steamship company, almost everywhere he goes, and the fact that this will create thousands of new jobs.
Right.
And we saw this morning, Memphis is ranked as the poorest metro region in the entire nation.
Right, and we've got that, Andy. I'm going to bring you in. You've been covering Electrolux as well. The it did come out today. The census numbers: 19% of people in the metro area and 8-county area living in poverty. The unemployment rate still in the 10%. It's down a little bit. But you've got people who are real skeptical about the amount of incentives that the city, county, and state have put forward, Electrolux particularly, but all these deals. I mean, big deals that Amos just mentioned, Riviana Foods, Kruger, the paper manufacturer. I mean, there are billions of dollars, I mean, nearly $1 billion that I added up in announcements in the last year that theoretically thousands of jobs, a lot of investment, but there are skeptics who say that this is not that city and county and government shouldn't be in the incentives game to get these kind of people to come to town.
That's right. Arguably, it's the nature of at least local government these days. They've almost become venture capital firms putting up money to make deals happen where they otherwise wouldn't happen, for better or for worse. I mean, that's just the way it is. Take Electrolux. Memphis was, we got, there was some competition with Canada and Mexico, and it's not just Memphis competing with Nashville anymore. It's like across state lines and across.
No, I remember Houston being mentioned, and whether it was Electrolux or it was Mitsubishi, they were in the mix. And this whole, the argument about the incentives, the people in favor of them say, well, maybe theoretically in isolation, these incentives are no good, but when every other city or so many other cities are doing it.
You are living in fantasy land if you think city, county, and state governments should not offer incentives to bring employers here.
Well, and I would make the point.
You might as well throw up a close for business sign.
That sign was up for about 10 years. The latter part of the Harrington administration.
I would
there
agree.
Was very, we weren't, the city was not in the
We didn't
incentives
even have a director
game.
Of economic development for a period of 2 years.
Right.
That's how bad it was.
I think some of the frustration, though, is that we were at this point of playing the incentive game, certainly in the mid-1980s. And I think people see the same chorus coming around again. And at some point, if we're going to change what most people admit, if you were looking at it in isolation without the pressure from everybody else doing it, is a bad way to grow an economy.
Right.
So hopefully, at the end of this cycle, when and if the economy comes back, we'll take the time to look at this and figure out, is there a better way of producing economic growth?
Here is something to note, and I'm not sure that most people really understand this, the pilot program. People, when companies are enrolled in that program, they are paying taxes
Right. They're paying corporate taxes.
And they're paying property taxes, right, just at a pre-development level. Say Electrolux, right, that property is not producing any revenue right now.
Right.
Once production starts, they will be paying tax revenue to the city and county.
The other point that, you know, I would make that I think is interesting about Electrolux, and the groundbreaking is next week or so, but it's one of many deals. If Electrolux was the only deal that the city were pursuing and putting these incentives out in front of, well, then you're putting all your eggs in that basket, and there's a chance Electrolux will bomb.
Right.
But if you've got multiple deals out there, it's like a venture capitalist. You mentioned that, Andy. You know, a venture capitalist goes and invests, and a certain number of those deals are going to go bad, but you don't stop investing because of that. You know, Silicon Valley didn't stop investing in high tech just because Netscape went under. And
right,
so that's the game that the city has embraced.
They may catch a Facebook
right
around them.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Well, let's move on. Again, talking about economic issues, let's just touch real quickly on a number of local companies that reported either earnings or some big news this week. Let's start, Bill, with FedEx, which on the surface, the headline was a real positive one. They're up 20-something percent profits. There were some real great results for the quarter, but they had some warnings for the future.
Yeah, the earnings call this week for the second quarter were really, really going to be watched closely because FedEx was really flying high in June. Fred Smith, the founder of the company, was really optimistic, saying, yeah, we believe we went through a soft patch. That's the phrase he used. And now we're on the and we see growth coming. Well, there was some growth in some of FedEx's sectors, but FedEx Express was the one that was being watched, and they got hit pretty hard by a pretty rapid drop-off in the shipments or people deciding to purchase electronics, the cell phones, the technology, things like that. And it's an economic indicator of people taking a real second look and not having much confidence in the economy.
And we talk about this in the context of yesterday. You know, the market on Thursday was down some nearly 400 points worldwide. There was a huge, you know, fall off in the stock market. There's a lot of jitteriness out there. And yet again, a big Memphis company, AutoZone, reported record profits, I think record revenue. Mm-hmm. Real quickly, can you walk through that? They were talking about some really good stuff.
Yeah, and this is kind of a different interpretation on the economy being slow. And Andy's talked about this a good deal because you're dealing with something different than electronics. You're dealing with parts for people who might be keeping their cars longer.
All right, we're going to leave it there and segue into a sidebar and start with a story that came out in the Commercial Appeal this week, Amos, that Bass Pro, soon to be, we think, a big player in Memphis, talking about incentives and talking about big deals that were signed in the last year. Bass Pro's coming into the pyramid, but there was a lawsuit filed in federal court. Can you tell us about that briefly?
The Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, better known as the EEOC, filed a lawsuit alleging discriminatory hiring and operations practices by Bass Pro. Former employees are part of the case. And said that Bass Pro is discriminating against African Americans and other minorities in hiring and promotions. City leaders, you know, here basically said, you know, we're not too worried about that. We'll see how the case plays out. We are a majority African American city. Bass Pro is going to be hiring people, they say, from the Memphis area, the Memphis city limits, which means they'll likely be hiring African Americans.
And you had quotes from Robert Lipscomb, who is a big part of city leader, who's a big part of bringing Bass Pro to town, saying, look, you know, I'm not worried about it. These things happen. I think they're going to be hiring from an African-American pool. Robert Lipscomb happens to be African-American. There was not a lot of concern on the part of city leaders or the people who
none at all. Actually, none at all.
Okay.
You didn't hear any. No one said this. Oh, this is a red light. We're going to really have to stop this project and take a look at this. Say everything is full steam ahead on that.
Okay, and we've got Bass Pro. They had a response from the company. The investigation and the EEOC's conduct demonstrate a troubling tendency by the EEOC to stereotype those who love outdoor sports and support conservation as people who unlawfully discriminate or oppose equal opportunity for all. That was Mike Rowland, the Vice President of Human Resources there. So, you know, I mean, it's one thing when you bring a big national company in town. I mean, FedEx gets sued sometimes. They have worker comp deals. You know, AutoZone gets sued sometimes. Some of these big players get sued, and it does happen.
This is also a lawsuit in Houston federal court. So keep in mind, Bass Pro Shops is headquartered in Springfield, Missouri. As you said, this is a large corporation. These are allegations about specific conduct in a certain part of the company.
All right, and our last story tonight, we'll start with you, Jackson, on Mulroy versus Rowland, the two county commission members who got into a bit of a heated debate recently. We're going to start with some sound, then talking about it, and we'll come back to you.
He actually breaks the sunshine law and asked me to vote for somebody, a guy named Christopher LaRoe. And we were sitting in there, and we were just joking. I told him we could have I said, here's what we'll do. Let's have a celebrity boxing match, and whoever wins can have it their way.
He walked right up to me, nose to nose, real mad, yelling at me, saying, I've had it with you. Let's settle this with a fist fight. When I made a joke, he said, I'm serious, bare knuckles. Let's go downstairs. I made another joke, and then finally he backed up, and we started talking about celebrity boxing. So, I mean, it was, listen, I know what the difference is between someone who's joking and someone who's trying to physically intimidate.
Jackson, this is the kind of stuff that gives people great faith in their elected leaders. When they act like my teenage boys arguing over a PlayStation. Go ahead, give us your take.
We call this segment the sidebar. This is actually a sideshow for the sidebar. Depending on who you believe, Mulroy certainly made it sound very serious, very ominous. He thought he was being threatened. And even though he wasn't sure that he was going to have a punch thrown at him, he did believe very seriously he was being intimidated. Rowland, makes it sound like a big joke. And since we just heard Terry Rowland's voice, I'm not going to do my customary Terry Rowland imitation.
Thank you.
I'm not going to compete with him directly.
We had it live.
Yeah. Clearly, that indicates the serious divisions that exist on that commission, and they've gotten kind of out of hand, really.
All right. Well, we leave it there. Thanks for joining us. See you next week.